conference. I'm here with my co-worker and good friend, Mauricio Sugihara.
Sugihara.
Who is working with me here in Brazil. He's been working with me for about a year now. He agreed to sit down for a conversation with Kip. So I asked him, I said, what would we talk about? And I don't think you had an idea.
No.
I said, so Mauricio, you've been working now in kind of with the things I've been talking about for a year now. Maybe we'd talk a little bit about your impressions. Why don't you give a little bit of your background
first? So I'm a production engineer. Graduated from Federal University in São Carlos here in Brazil. And I have an MBA with concentration in finance, so related to the field. I've been working with financial services for most of my life in consulting and as a client. And I joined IBM a year ago.
Yeah. So?
Impressions.
What are your impressions?
So I think that for the longest time, most of our clients have overlooked the importance of having atomic data to decision making. So when we reach out to them to explore those topics, usually they have rather consolidated data and inference rather than having the information. So for the year I've been with IBM, we've been helping clients figure out the best way to approach this, and more often than not, they've done a lot of things in the past and just threw money out of the window.
Yep. You know, so there's a couple of thoughts that come to mind about things that you've taught me. One was a conversation we had just a few minutes ago, but let me come back to that.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing was when we started talking about this, I don't know, maybe it was 9 months ago, started going through the instrument ledger and the kinds of things, you started to talk about, well, behaviors.
Yes.
So what does that mean?
Yeah, behavior. So when we talk CRM, for instance, usually it's really tied to non-financial type things,
yep,
right?
Yes.
So one field that I think is really overlooked is how we can add predictive analytics to the financial behavior of clients. So especially in financial services where you have risks associated to the regular business, ideally you would be wanting to predict when a customer of yours is going into default.
Yes.
And when you have to consume all your provisions, which in turn eats up on your P&L. So when we have the instrument ledger, we have such a level of granularity available to the financial services companies, they can start working on that. Even if it's very preliminary, at least they now have the information to get to a point when they can say, hey, this cash flow tends to lead to a default.
This sort of thing.
So you can act proactively and say, well, let me call the client and say, do you have an interest of a different type of loan?
Yep.
Can you refinance a portion of what, you know, your house or your car? So you don't eat up your reserves, right? But you can definitely service better your client. And they don't even need to know that they're going into the fold. They might not even know, right?
Yep.
So that is, I think, where the edge will take us when we get to that point. We're going to, and it's a safer financial services environment altogether.
Well, and you think about, we do in CRM world, we focus for a number of years on other kinds of data around the customer.
Definitely,
to predict,
yes,
their behaviors.
Exactly.
But my financial decisions are things that I probably consider more carefully than many other kinds of behaviors I have. So the quality and the importance of that data as expressed in a financial transaction that I make,
definitely,
it's gonna, it should help me get to better understanding of my customers much more.
That and the sequence of decisions you've done financially,
yes,
will lead you to a behavior. Over time, when you repeat actions that incorporates into behavior, that behavior can indicate that your client might be going into default.
Yes, and like you said, one of the aspects of that could be you're offering something to the customer that they actually need, that they don't even know that they need.
They
you
don't
are
even
helping
know.
Them.
Exactly.
Because you're the expert in that field, whatever it is, whether it's financial services or anything else, you know that field better. And so helping the customer with your expertise by having that data can be.
You can trace a direct relationship between balances accumulated over time, financial transactions over time, to behavior.
Yes.
A determined behavior is an accumulation of different financial decisions that the clients made, right? If I decide to, instead of paying a loan, I'll pay my utility bill, that is a decision. Over time, it becomes a pattern, and the pattern indicates the behavior as much as balance is a reflection of the whole life of the transactions, right? So it's a direct one-to-one relationship, which, you know, currently we're not really using to the benefit of the client, of the financial services company, and in the market.
So one other point that we talked about that I mentioned earlier, materiality as a concept,
yes,
in reporting, right?
Yep.
In some respects, we've used that as an excuse for why our data is the way that it is. We don't have accuracy, and in some cases, it was impossible to have greater accuracy. But in today's world, more and more data is coming in already pre-recorded. I mean, it's going straight from machines to machines, right? We don't have people writing things in ledgers as much anymore and transcribing and that sort of thing.
That's right, yes.
So our excuses around materiality, if materiality is an excuse, and this is one of the problems, when we aggregate, it takes away our ability to understand the details behind the customer,
yes,
to understand what the data was telling us.
Exactly. You lose behavior.
You lose
information
behavior.
About behavior.
Behavior.
Yes. And if we take, for instance, how IFRS is evolving.
Yes.
And recently we were talking about IFRS 15, which in a nutshell, it requires a company to recognize revenue only when an obligation in the contract is being fulfilled. So if you don't have an instrument ledger with underlying information that you can say, oh, this is when the obligation was met, you probably under IFRS 15 might not even be able to recognize revenue at all.
Yes.
And you know, we want our clients to recognize
that's right.
revenue,
yeah,
and you be able to do that on a very efficient basis. So when you tie the regulation that is incoming, imposing that degree of needing a detailed level of information through the life of the contract, that speaks directly to the instrument ledger.
Yeah.
There's no way around it because, you know, IFRS is upon us.
Yes.
Right.
Right. And then we have to increase the accuracy. We have to have better measurement.
That's right.
In order to run our business
staff.
And be more efficient in what we do. You know, it's rewarding to me. I've worked in the space for a long time and I'm still discovering new things. Mauricio's insights, you know, helped me discover new things. The interactions with him today and over the last year. I enjoy working with customers, but Mauricio's kind of an example of a customer that when they catch on to these ideas and see how they can change things and the implications of them, it's rewarding to me. So I'm glad that
I appreciate it.
I appreciate you taking a moment here to share your insights on Conversations with Kip.
Cool.